work in the morning.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Justin Keller. I'm the Public Affairs Officer at CFAY. Just want to welcome you all to the third quarter CFAY Town Hall. So what we're going to do is we're going to have some of the different departments from around CFAY come up, present some of the events and the initiatives going around on the installation. And then we're going to read through some of the questions that we received through social media. And then after that, we'll get into the Q&A session and ask some questions. But before that, we're going to go ahead and pass it over to Captain Silva to open it up.
Hey, everybody. Hey, listen, I really appreciate everybody taking the time to come on out here and participate in the town hall. I see we have some Boy Scouts here, and I'm really happy to see you here. Hopefully, you get to see some real community magic happen this evening. So I really appreciate you fellas being here. As for everybody else, I appreciate your time and you know the effort that we all put in to make this place better. Justin, can we please kick it off?
Without further ado, Public Works Department.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Tyler Sharara, the Public Works Officer. I'll take you through a few topics we're working on around the base. The first is some of our major projects. It's an extremely busy base. I know we all live here and know that. On the right side there is a new building that the Navy is building on the base. It's called Navigation Seamanship Ship Handling Trainer, NSST. So it's being located in the parking lot of the ATG building on the map there. Over the last year, we understood that new project was going to take about 70 spots, and we built around 70 new spots in those yellow areas. So there's additional 12-hour parking in the front of the NGIS Annex. So you drive up over Command Hill and down, it's very easy access off base via the boardwalk and Kearney Gate. And then another about dozen spots there by the Kearney Gate DLA DAPS building. So we offset the building losses. We understand there's also some temporary construction losses related to that area. We're closely watching the SRF garage and other areas that are available for parking. On the waterfront side, you see several of those utility projects have started. A few are happening later in the year, but we're doing some major reinvestment in the waterfront utilities, and that does take some space. We'll have some temporary generators out there to provide ship power and some lay down areas for that work. Getting rid of solid waste in Japan is a bit complicated. Right? There's a lot of rules and regulations about how we sort it and how we dispose of it. So you can help us by using this new guide. It was published on Facebook. It'll be handed out in housing packets. It's provided to the building managers. So starting on the left there, you can reuse products. Please have people deliver household hazardous materials. That's like Windex, Simple Green, bleach. And if you want to use it, go pick it up free there. And then as you move left to right, there's other options. You can recycle via different entities. We make money on recycling, and we reinvest that in products on the base. If you absolutely have to throw it in solid waste trash, please do that. And there's some numbers there if you need to have a bulk pickup, like a mattress, or have a dumpster for a large event. There's numbers for the solid waste disposal. We also are piloting a battery disposal program. So the batteries end up in lots of different places, but we're going to try and make it simple for you. Right now, it's only at the next main building. We're going to assess this pilot program and see where to expand it and how to expand it. But now, if you can get your batteries just to that consolidated disposal, we will take it from there. And we'll, please try to put it in the right bucket by manufacturer and type. But we'll get it to the right place. We make money on some of them. We don't on others. And we will dispose of them or recycle as appropriate. Thank you. I'll now turn it over to N9.
Good evening. Starting off with Family Food Support Center, Stop Domestic Violence Month. So October events highlighting domestic violence will be going on. One October Domestic Violence Awareness Month. Month proclamation is going to be taking place from 11:30 to 12 o'clock, and that's going to be at Kosana Park Gazebo. Also, 17th of October, we'll have the Walk a Mile in Their Shoes. That's from 09:30 to 1100. At the Purdy Gazebo. So please take some time and participate in this event that our folks in FFSC are putting together for the community. Moving forward, arts and crafts, of course, Halloween's coming right around the corner. So we want to make sure we have things out for our kids within the community in support of the EFMP month. October 8th at 1430 Senior Saint Building, we're going to have on the fourth floor, 3365, this building here. at the Natsu room, and that's open to all hands. So please, if you have time, make sure you bring your little ones so that you can go ahead and participate in this event. Letters to Santa come in December. I know December's a couple months down the road, but we make sure we start running fast here, and we get all those nice names and all that information from your little ones, all those letters brought in. That way our team can get together and actually make sure that your kids get those special letters for them. So please make sure you keep eyes open and submit those letters. Moving forward to N92, there's a lot of events going on in the community. Hot Chill Ray, I like saying Hot Chili Ray, but Hot Chill Ray. that's happening September 28th. So this is going to be a big event. Of course, Preble's coming in. This is how we want to welcome this new event coming on board. So definitely a lot of great things happening. If you don't know who this group is, pull up the song Tonight Tonight. You'll figure it out right away. You've heard it on the radio a million times.
Singing
is called. My boys ain't there yet. I'm working on it. It's a little more karaoke. So 6 p.m. of course is when it's going to start. Free admission to all, and that's going to be in the bowling parking lot. Halloween club events, many events going on in the bowling center, Club T, the CPO club. So please keep your eyes open, look at the Ahoy. We have a lot of things going on during the Halloween time. One of the big ones is, of course, we're going to have Zombie Run going on as well. So please keep your eyes open for those dates and times. The big one, Yokosuka Friendship Day, that's going to be Sunday, October 6th at 10 a.m. We're expecting, you know, if it rains, roughly about 30,000. If it's not raining, maybe 50,000 people on board this space. This is a huge event in the community. A lot of great things happening. Our community comes together with our folks and friends outside of that gate. So please, if you've never been to one of these friendship days, I highly recommend you come out and participate. Another big event, J-Bug. If you don't know who that is, it's a Pacific reggae band. Very famous. They've been here several times. So it's always been a really big hit with the community. They're going to be here Friday, October 11th, and actually at the bowling alley parking lot as well. Spooktacular Fall Festival, 5K Zombie Run. Supposed to be a nice big event. We've had it two times before. It's going to be the third time we run this. It's been a pretty great event. A lot of folks are like participating in it. Kids, adults, everybody can participate in this 5K Zombie Run. Trunk or Treat, Halloween bowling pin. These are all things that are going to be happening Friday, October 25th, and this is all going to be taking place at Berkeley Field. Thanksgiving to go. Of course, we're already starting to push that information out. Thanksgiving is right around the corner as well. That way you place your orders for your Thanksgiving dinner. If you want to go ahead and not cook, let somebody else cook for you at home, right? Moving forward to housing. When it comes to housing, of course, ours is going to be a little more boring. Not a lot of marketing, but it's going to be specific to what's going on in the community, instructions, and so on. The big one that we're always pushing out is pet policies, making sure we're actually out there taking care of our pets, making sure we're being good owners and also good neighbors, picking up after our pets and so on, making sure we have no more than two pets, that if you see somebody doing the wrong thing, please don't go up to them and try to confront anybody. If you identify it, let us know. My team will actually be able to look into the matter, and that way they can support you better. That way you're not having to deal with any issues with any of your neighbors. Just provide the information, we'll definitely look into it and we'll get engaged. When it comes to ongoing projects, main-based townhouses, of course, there's a lot of projects going on. Upgrading of the windows, upgrading of doors. Another big one is when it comes to the fencing, that's all in progress. All of these townhouses on main-based will have all these upgrades. Pretty much between now and 2027 is what we're looking at. So that's definitely a big push. Whole house renovations for Ikego, 80 townhouses, that's phase three, will be completed by November of this year. And then of course phase four, 96 townhouses as well, that will be completed roughly about February 26th. The biggest push here when it comes to these specific phases three and four is that even though we're getting these houses back, we're not gonna be able to utilize them unfortunately until phase five takes place. And the reason behind it is infrastructure. So phase five actually will be infrastructure related, meaning pipes, electrical, all that has to be renovated in all these homes. Unfortunately, that was the way that it was set up prior to any of us being here. So we have to work with that instead of moving somebody in and then having to move a family out, because it takes roughly about 3 months, whether your power or your water and all that's down in that home. So that's gonna take a little time, but phase five has been awarded. And the first thing that's gonna be taking place when phase five kicks off is actual mechanical room, so that we can get all that infrastructure completed right away. As soon as they give us a green light, then we'll start moving those families in. Radon mitigation, as we all know, there was some radon testing conducted here. Just so, you know, for those of you that are not familiar with radon, radon's everywhere. Most places do not test for radon. The Navy has gone above and beyond and tested for radon. The reason people don't test for radon is because anywhere in the U.S., if you test for radon, there is a requirement that if those numbers are above the authorized amount, I mean the authorized numbers, by law you have to mitigate radon. And guess what? It ranges about $15,000 to $20,000 to do so. However, there is no law that requires you to test it. So landlords will not test their homes for radon. However, we want to make sure that you have that peace of mind, that you're taking care of it, and that you know that we care and that we're doing the right thing by your side. So we tested our homes. We had several homes that came up, not high numbers, nothing crazy, but we still said we're going to mitigate these homes. 64 units on main base required mitigation by no later than October 11th for 25. The team was already on board surveying. Now next time they come back, it's going to be with the equipment to actually install it. It takes a couple hours to install a mitigation system in your home. So definitely something we're going to be dealing with here in the near future. But very minor. We won't be bothering you or having you move out the house. Some things we could do from outside. It might have to go inside your home for maybe an hour of that. But definitely something we will work with. 39 units currently undergoing pre-mitigation diagnostic inspection, and that's been going on from the 4th to the 25th of September. And then upcoming projects, as I mentioned earlier, phase five, of course, that's 38 townhouses. The biggest thing within phase five is what I mentioned earlier, which is the infrastructure, those utility rooms that will support your homes. Duncan Playground upgrade. Duncan Playground has been down for quite a while, as many of us know. Unfortunately, it takes some time. Of course, we got to pump and get things going and get that funding approved. But we're finally at that stage. Design was completed, now we're good. So we're moving forward with actually completion. November 25 is when that will be completed. And we went a little above this time. We went ahead and not only did we look at setting up a playground there, but there's gonna be a gazebo added to it. So definitely it's gonna be a lot nicer. Duncan Townhouse backyard storage. That's gonna be all those resistant sheds you have behind your homes, pretty much all those metal sheds you have behind your townhouses, all of those will be removed. And we're gonna put concrete sheds back there to prevent them from flying away when a typhoon or some high winds come. We don't want none of that to happen. We don't want nobody to get hurt. So we're gonna make sure we work with the contractors actually setting up the fencing so we can make sure we push it as far into that fencing to prevent you having to worry about cutting the grass around the fence or cutting the grass around that those tight little edges. So we'll make sure we take care of that and we do it correctly with that collaboration. Moving forward, security, thank you.
All right, good evening folks. And Henson Hunt, CFAY Security. We talked to you about a couple of our ongoing areas of focus. So with school being back in full effect, got some folks doing some not proper driving activities. They're dropping their kids off in unauthorized drop-off zones. They're rolling stop signs, distracted driving. So we're increasing our presence in those areas because, again, our main goal is to keep the community safe, keep the kids safe. So please, if you guys see anybody, that brings me to my next point. Down here, you'll see our reporting numbers. Please call these folks in, license plates, vehicle makes, models. You know the person, take care of it, all right? So 2300, 2301 for non-emergencies, and then 911 for emergency, and there's a cell phone number for 911. Moving on to our future areas focus. So we've already started, but you may see in the coming months a lot of folks in different uniforms, on base, with guns, in Humvees. Don't be alarmed, those are our host nation partners. We are ramping up for base certification and large scale exercises. So we've invited our host nation partners to come on base, do exercises with us. So what that means is there may be some delays entering and exiting the base. There may be some areas that aren't normally off limits, but now are for a short period of time. And that's just for us to be able to conduct these drills and exercises and training with our joint partners to ensure everybody else is safe. And the last note is our VCC project. Thank you, community, for your patience. Everything has moved over to Club A, as you all have seen, probably. Just want to let you guys know that project is tracking on time and expected to be completed January 2025. So with that, turn it over to Religious Services.
Thanks. Good evening, everyone. Chaplain David Kim. I'm the command chaplain for the base. It's an exciting time for us at the chapel. A lot of our fall programs have already kicked off. The biggest program is actually our Roman Catholic Catechism program that kicked off last weekend, but there's still time for you to register your children if you'd like to be involved with that, so just scan that QR code. They're also looking for volunteers always to help teach, but please get involved in that if you were part of that community. Also, for our Protestant community, our children's program, Awana, takes place on Sunday afternoons, and that will be kicking off this Sunday. So, again, whether you are a member of the chapel or not, your kids are welcome to come join us on Sunday afternoons. And again, the registration is with that QR code over there. Protestant Women of the Chapel kicked off a few Tuesdays ago. They have a session on Tuesday mornings that meets at the chapel, but also they have an evening session as well for those who work during the day. Both of those are at our chapel on Tuesday. So please look into that if you're interested. Also, the early October timeframe is the Jewish high holidays, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and so our Jewish community is going to be very active. These are just a kind of a snapshot of different programs and different services that are there. They always welcome people who are just curious to check it out as well, so please feel free to drop by. And on the lower right is a QR code for our Facebook site. We have sessions, we have different things that are constantly changing, so please check that for the latest information. One last thing I want to point out, Credo does not have any specific local events this month, but they said to please check them out. Since these are quarterly, over the next quarter there definitely will be events, so please check this QR code out. There's a Trumba site that makes it very easy to sign up for events, so please check them out over the next few weeks. They'll have events be populating that website pretty soon. That's all I have.
Hello, everyone. So, in the hospital, one thing that we're offering up to everyone is something called the Fall into Fitness Challenge. It's actually a program that we're looking at and we started at the hospital, basically to focus on weight loss management. Anyone can sign up, whether you do it at the hospital, in our E22, or in a Fleet Rec, a wellness center in Fleet Rec. We want to get a lot of participants. As part of this, we actually do a body scan with the Tanita Bioelectric Impedance Scanner. It's a scan. You stand on this platform. It's kind of like a scale, bare feet, not wet, and it actually does an assessment of your body electronically, and it actually gives you a lot of information about your fat content, your muscle content, and then that way when you go through the challenge and you exercise, you can then see the difference after the challenge. And it's one of the new ways that the Navy is beginning to decide if we're going to do assessments for actual sailors in the future. And so we're taking one step ahead of time to test it out to see what it's like for everyone. We also will have a Fall into Women's Health, as is the second Women's Health Day, essentially. Pap smears, STI screening, contraceptive services, but also we'll be doing walk-in mammograms in our radiology department in the hospital. And so this is open to anyone, and so we just want to make sure that if you are coming, since we have a lot of new beneficiaries coming to the area, please ensure that you're registered in our patient admin area so that way we can actually do the studies and allow you to walk in without having to register on the data event and it'll delay you. But the intent is to allow people to come in very fast without needing a scheduled appointment for Women Health Services. This is a plug for our Patient and Family Partnership Council. And so this is an opportunity for anyone who wants to be involved in bettering patients' experience in our hospital to come and talk with us. It's held, the next meeting is going to be held on October 2nd, 12 to 1300 in the medical library. I actually bring my directors from the hospital into the meeting. So if you have a concern about a specific area of the hospital, I have that director who owns that area present or one of the representatives. If we can't answer the question there at the meeting, we will give an answer back to you. And this is an opportunity, it's expansion of trying to not only work with the community and work with our stakeholders, but to get the questions and get things answered before it becomes a much bigger issue. Because if one person has a concern, that means other people may have a concern. And it's better to address it early when someone first finds out about it, as opposed to months later when 40 to 50 people have found out about it. It allows us to get input that we can't get from patients, because usually when we're seeing you in a hospital, the reality is you are actually considered a sensitive in a vulnerable state. So we don't want to talk to you about things that are wrong with the hospital while you're in the hospital. This gives an opportunity to bring those things up after the fact, after you've thought about them. And sometimes we actually get answers of how we can fix it from these meetings. So please, if you're interested, you can pass the word. We don't have any restrictions on who comes, and if we need a bigger venue, we will find a bigger venue. But this is supposed to be getting information from our stakeholders. And we're also going to be doing the next iteration of our sports physicals on October 5th. And so this is for students participating in DODEA-sponsored school physicals. This has gone out to the schools themselves. Some of the parents may have actually already been informed from the schools. So all the sports team, the coaches have already been informed in both the high school and the middle school, pass out information as well. And so the intent is to try to do it all at one time, also decreasing the need to schedule appointments in the hospital. And so this is walk-in, and we also will see base dependents. So if you work on the base and you have a dependent and they're going to DODEA school, they can also come and we will do the physicals at that time. Just informing everyone, vaccinations. It is that time of the season where the flu shots will be coming. And so these are the times and dates for our mass flu vaccinations. We will have the team go to both Yokosuka and the main base during those times, and it's just walk in. Just come on in and we will give you your flu shot. And these are more times and more dates, mostly for November.
Can you go back?
Yeah, October, so this is October.
Okay.
Does everyone still see phones? Are you ready for November?
Yeah.
Okay, let's do November.
Thank you.
And lastly, this is more of a advisory. On the 29th and 30th of October, we will be doing a hospital drill. And so we're preparing our hospital for much larger drills, but also meeting a requirement for our hospital by the Navy to actually be prepared in case we have mass casualties or other responses for here on base. So we will have limited services. The ED will, of course, always will be open. We will have a few appointments still available in primary care, but if we can, the team will try to avoid a number of patients coming through the hospital for throughput on those 2 days. And that's all I have. Thank you very much.
All right, so we're going to transition to our Q&A portion. We took in some questions from the community through social media, so we're going to go ahead and start with those before we move in to open up the questions. First question is, does CFAY have a suggestion box for the commanding officer? If so, where can I find it?
Okay, there's a suggestion box in my building, C2. But more importantly, if anybody needs to come see me, I'm not hard to find. Every month I open up my office for breaking the ice. If anyone wants to come talk to me, feel free to come talk to me about that. Moreover, we're out in Yokosuka once a month for a cup of joe with the CO, and we're out there to just engage with the community and answer any questions anybody may have. So if there's anything on anybody's mind or they want to discuss something, we are really easy to find, and more importantly, I give very direct answers to questions. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Next question is for you, sports. While the new sign-up system for youth sports allows more children to register, it's difficult for families to plan because we don't know if our child got into the sport, when practices will be, or when games will start. For example, registration opened on July 29th for sports starting the week of October 14th, but children were placed on wait list immediately and families have not been informed of the status.
took some notes to make sure I answer the whole question. All right, so I'm Rashawn Terry. I'm the Youth Sports Director. We run our program based on volunteer-based program. Without volunteers, we're not able to confirm your spots at that time. But once we get coaches signed up, so once registration starts, we have spots open that's available. That means we have coaches. And then once those spots are filled, then we start a wait list. Once we get coaches, we pull those respective parents from the wait list from number one all the way to how many that'll make that team. So for example, if CSO needs a Tuesday, Thursday, but a Monday, Wednesday is available, we contact him because he's the first one on the wait list. If Captain Sobo needs a Tuesday, Thursday, and he's number two, we still contact the number one person. So I'm sorry. For questions about practice schedules, it's given to you when you register your kids for the 5 to 8 year olds. For the older kids, we gotta do a skill assessment, so you won't get those times until after that. After the coaches meeting, the coaches will get their rosters and they'll send you an email about your practice times. If you have a question about your status on the wait list, please just contact us directly. Call us, email us, come by the office, we're open. Come say hi to my clerk, she's by herself now. Let's come by and say hello. Question about game schedules, you'll get that pretty much when the game schedule is done. We also do a parents meeting as well to go over information about the season as well. So we had over 400 people registered for soccer. We only had 30 parents in the parent meeting. So that's the gap right there. So please make sure you guys try your best to make that parent meeting. And how can this be improved? We need more coaches. If you have kids that's playing in multiple age groups for that sport, all of them will be free. We also give out LOAs for active duty members as well, so they can track their hours.
Thank you, Rashawn. Next question was for DECA. When will shopping bags be removed and how will this change affect the click-to-go service? So actually reached out to Mr. Magoski. He wasn't able to be here tonight. We passed along that that's actually going to be paused for right now. Whenever that's unpaused and they decide to go forward, that we're going to make sure we'll put that up to the community with plenty of enough time to make sure everyone is ready for it. And the next question was for emergency management. It was during the last typhoon, we received a landslide, flood, and tornado warnings off base. I wasn't sure where to go because I didn't know the local evacuation sites. If there's an evacuation order, where should we go?
Hey, good evening, everyone. Reggie Toledo, Emergency Management Officer. So, in anticipation of a storm and declaration of T42, the Emergency Management Department initiates and activates the shelter at Fleet Rec Gym. All residents are encouraged to use the gym if you fear or feel that the storm is threatening you whatsoever. So, for off base, once we receive the information from the city government that the shelters are activated, we will coordinate with PAO and put out there to at the social media page or via our mass onboarding notification that the shelters are activated. Thank you.
Thank you, Reggie. Next question. It's for me. Organizations on base need better ways to communicate events besides Facebook. There's so many organizations focused only on Facebook that it's hard to keep track of events, policies, cancellations, but I've spent a lot of time online. I think that's one of the first things I noticed when I came here. I think some of that is a little bit of the COVID lockdowns. I think a lot of people went to Facebook and that's where a lot of the communication went. But I would like to remind everyone, we do have one of the biggest, we have a lot of communications channels. So we also have the MyCFAY Weekly Newsletter. We have the MWR Hawaii Magazine, which you can go to the MWR website and sign up for that. All of MWR's information is in there. The Weekly goes out weekly every Friday. You can sign up through Yokosuka Report at gmail.com. Captain Sobel's also on the radio, AFN Radio, every morning at 7:30. We're on the Command Channel. And one of the other big things we got coming up is the marquees. So we've purchased 4 new marquees and we're working to get those installed hopefully here before the end of the year. So there'll be actually one out in front of this building and one in front of the Fleet Rec. Main gate is getting changed out and then we're going to have one in a Kago as well. So really excited about getting those. It's going to be helpful to get information out to everyone. And then also this fall, we're going to be doing a communication survey just to see where are you looking for your information and where would you like to look for information? How can we better align our communication strategies to match up to that? Next question, Public Works. With parking becoming more limited, can Yokopon shuttle services be expanded? Maybe add one running in the opposite direction.
Oh, sure. I love doing this one. Tyler, I think I got this one. So this one's my favorite question because it comes up every single meeting that we have, and it's actually our best answer. Because what we did was we had a study. Captain Jarrett did a study, and it wasn't. And what was the name of the company? It wasn't just NAVFAC, it was somebody else too. So Brain Study came in and said, hey, what's the most efficient way to run these buses? And how can we get people all the way around? And the answer was, if you run them one way, you cut out a bunch of stops, and these are the ways you go, this is the most efficient way you can get it. And so that's where we went. And so I know anecdotally, on certain days it's slower, or you think you're, but that's the one reason on why it runs that way. Number two, this is a workshop. So we're a victim of our own success here in that the Yokopon's a cute name and we want to use it as a bus. So I tried to get it to, I pitched a couple ideas to Captain Soul for Work Shuttle Alpha and Work Shuttle Bravo to be so that people know that, hey, this really isn't, this is, families can use this as space available and absolutely please use it as space available. We want you to use it as space available, but it is not for us. It's for our MLC workers who don't traditionally have the vehicles. Therefore, getting on the base when Japan does a great job in public transport, I don't know if you, I'm sure you all are aware of that. And then when you get on base, what did the Melly study say, Tyler? It's like you're in Omaha, Nebraska. We don't have that type of infrastructure. That's because we don't have that type of infrastructure. So the Yokopon shuttle is an SRF shuttle that we are allowing our people to utilize. And so why does it slow down on weekends? Because the work happens during the week. And so that's why we have it. So we acknowledge it's not everything you want. We talked about, well, what if we pay for a service? Then we can absolutely talk to the exchange and see if people want to pay for a service, like a bus system to go around. You could do that, but it's going to be real hard to compete with free. And so that's kind of the answer. And so I know it's really unfulfilling. 15 minutes during the weekday, 30 minutes on the weekends. And that's what it comes around to. There was also a question about air trackers or tracking the bus as it goes around so you know the timing. It's a base. It's a base and that's a force protection issue. So we're not gonna tell you what our congestion times are and which way that is. It's just not gonna happen. So I think that gets after the answer. I know it's gonna come up next question. I'm gonna get better at this speech. I'm gonna really work on this, but that's the answer.
All right, thank you, sir. Next one is a shout out to Public Works. I can't be there for the town hall, but just wanted to say thank you for the battery disposal area.
He wrote that himself.
Yeah, sure. Next question is for safety. Can you help stop pedestrians from walking the bike lane between the sidewalk detour on Nimitz between Clement and Gridley? It's a safety concern because the bike lane is already narrow due to construction. Wrong way cyclists are also a problem.
Hi, good evening, everybody. My name is Amanda Gross. I'm with CFAY Safety. The short answer is no, we can't. The long answer is that please understand that every construction project is vetted through all of the different departments. We take a very thorough look at all this, everything, especially when it comes to safety. I walked that particular area as well as a couple of the other areas on this installation where we have similar projects going on. And if you take a moment, the signage is prominently displayed right in front of where the crosswalks are that are supposed to be utilized. Unfortunately, I cannot control people who choose to not obey the rules and regulations. So, as a matter of fact, on my way here, I actually pulled over with my hazard lights and had a short conversation with one of the sailors who was walking through the construction area. When I asked them, hey, did you not see the signage? You know, because I thought maybe something wasn't quite right, they just simply said, oh, I didn't even see it there. But bear in mind, it's a bright orange. So, that being said, if you do have any other areas of concern, please bring them up to CFAY Safety. We thoroughly investigate everything. If I could hand out tickets and citations to all the cyclists that we see every single day that are not obeying the rules of the road, man, we'd make a lot of money for MWR. Unfortunately, we just can't enforce it. So, thank you.
All Next question. Will the parking spots reserved for specific titles or commands be made available for general use? This does not include disabled or Gold Star parking spots.
We do understand parking's tight. We've looked at every angle. We've repaved several parking lots this year, Fleet Theater, Van Decker, PSD. We redesigned Command Hill. We did near the NSST area. Everywhere we went, we shrunk reserve parking to what we could. There are still some reserve spots. There's some CO spots out there. There's government vehicle spots. Near shopping areas, there's customer spots, like 15-minute customer, pregnant women, COs, Mass Chiefs near the Chiefs Club. And so some of that does exist, but I don't think it's overflowing. And everywhere we've repaved and reallocated parking, we've looked heavily at that and tried to get each command to have a reasonable amount. So it has shrank a little bit, whether you see it or not, around the NSST, around the Command Hill area.
I want to talk about parking real quick. Yes. I think this bears in mind, right? So I've been in command for 2 years, and from the first day I got here in command, I noticed that parking was an issue. And I'd just like to remind everybody that me and Tyler got here at the same time, and we looked at one another and we said we need to increase parking. So we pushed projects to put up parking garages. But the minute you hit go, it takes 3 years before construction starts. So next year, what's going to start, Tyler?
We'll start two new garages and a surface lot over the next, starting next year for several years, and that'll be 1,000 spots on the community side of base.
So what's going to happen is you guys are going to get a new captain, you get a new public works officer. As soon as you get it, you're going to see these parking garages go up, and you're going to see, you know what? Thank God those old guys are gone, because the new guys are getting stuff done, and that is our gift to them. Okay.
One more question related to parking. I was told that the spots at the SRF parking garage are reserved for SRF 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Is that true?
No. The third floor of the SRF parking garage says the sign says SRF only. That is the only SRF area in that 9-floor garage. CSU SPAC has about 8 spots on the first floor, and NCIS has some on the fourth. But generally speaking, the rest of that parking lot is entirely open.
Tyler, if I wanted to find an empty parking spot at any point time of the day, because I know I make you go and count the empty parking spots, where do you go?
The top of parking garages are generally open. The top of Command Hill garage, the top of the SRF garage is almost always open. I know 9 floors up is not fun, but if you really need a spot, generally speaking, the top of our 9-story parking garages have spots. There is also an option to not do the elevator and park just simply a little bit further away, because there's usually a lot within a couple hundred yards if you're willing to try that walk instead. Yes.
Thank you very much. So that's all the questions that we've got from social media, so we'll go ahead and open up the floor if anyone has any questions or anything that you'd like to share. When back there first.
So I was told by housing that they would address the housing issue of the wide buildings getting moved, like Rokuban and Ichima got moved out of their buildings. And now there are people like me that are worried that their wide shaped building is also going to get moved. When I send them, they're like, oh, it's going to be addressed in the town hall.
So technically what's going on is it's a quality of life matter. For our sailors. When it comes to housing our sailors here, UH-wise, Congress has moved towards NDA requirements, meaning right now we're housing folks at IEP, interim assignment policy. That means we have 4 sailors living in one room, sharing one bathroom. It's kind of like living on the ship your whole life. Unfortunately, we've been doing this for quite a while. Many components have gotten ahead of it a long time ago. So we're actually playing catch up right now. That's really what's going on. In this installation, for example, if you look around, there's nowhere for us to start building. So we gotta be very innovative as per how we go about identifying places to grow for UH. That way we give our sailors a better quality of life. With that said, Ichiban, Rokuban, specifically. Those were the 2 first buildings we looked at. The reason we look at those two buildings first is because those were the ones with the lowest population, the lowest impact. Ichiban literally had 8 residents in it. Rokuban was the next one, which unfortunately, when we look at Rokuban, we had a total of 11 apartments empty. It's not a huge one, we're talking about 48 units, but it was actually lower than everyone else, which is Goban, Sanban, Yoban, and so on. So when it comes to what we're doing now, right now, this is actually a push from Congress, a requirement we have in place. We're housing more people than we have to. Let's be 100%. And that has to be, I mean, that's something that we all need to look at, is the fact that when we look at these regulations and these instructions, they don't all mesh. For example, the instruction for housing folks in UH clearly says that the only time I need to house somebody in UH is if a ship's in the shipyard. So
right,
you look
now,
at,
right now we have like 2 ships in the shipyard, but you know what? Master Chief stood up and said, we're not moving sailors back onto their ships. So that's why we're housing them in that manner. Because Master Chief said, don't move any sailors back onto their ships.
And then when we look at the other instructions, home port ashore program, which means when those ships are at port, we want to take all these kids off these ships and give them a place they could call home outside of that ship. So that's goes hand in hand with one another. With that said, the plan moving forward is to actually put no more than 2 sailors to 1 bathroom. There's 4 buildings currently being built on this installation. Some of those constructions you see going on, in the near future, you're gonna see the bowling alley disappear. Don't be frightened. They're gonna build a-
Relocate, new bowling alley.
No, no, and that's why I'm not forward. That's why I'm saying that, I like suspense. So bowling alley is going to disappear, but it's okay. You're going to get a brand new state-of-the-art bowling alley, and you're going to get a nice brand new food court, because the current food court that's by the waterside, eventually that's going to be integrated into that one facility as well. In that place where you see the current bowling alley, it's going to be a big U-shaped UH building that's going to house more than 800 sailors. Those units are going to be market-style living, means like full-blown apartment, common share area, kitchen. Each one of them has their own room with their own bathroom. So definitely a lot nicer, quality of life, definitely what, you know, our folks deserve to live in. These are some of the things that are taking place. Unfortunately, these buildings are not happening fast enough. As we all know, constructions take time. Even with those facilities going up, we will still not have enough units to be able to support the amount of sailors we have. Like right now, I'd say when the Jeep pulls in, right off the back, I got 1,600 sailors I need a house. That's not including the 400 plus Geo Bachelors that are coming along with them that I need to figure out how I can support, which eventually those numbers will lower. But when we look at the overall, we're talking about we got more than 3,500 sailors that we need a house, and we don't have the capacity with what we have and the buildings being built to support all those sailors right now. So the only way forward is for us to look at what we have surplus. Because when we look at CNIC's instruction, housing military families, and the reason I say that is, I only house military families. I don't house civilians. The civilians that are in my house is because they were grandfathered. And the moment that 5-year hits, they're out. And I get, you know, questions, I get waivers, and they all get denied. Why? Because I'm here to house military families. That's my number one priority. There's a lot of other things that go along with that. If I house civilians, CNIC doesn't consider that inventory utilization, meaning those houses are not being utilized because a civilian lives in it. If I house a civilian, I don't get funded to renovate or support that home. And another big factor here we need to look at is a civilian, me being one of them, our LQA is so high that we can live anywhere we want outside of that gate. So why would we sacrifice a military family's quality of life to give that home to a civilian that can afford to live outside of that gate wherever they want to live? So those are all factors. But when it comes to CNIC, 10% is the population that we have to house. That's the requirement, and we're definitely meeting, and we're actually going above that.
As to be clear, we have the inventory to support all the ships that are coming.
That is correct. We, with everything taking place, we'll have
the inventory to support all these ships coming on board. And by the way, we have an extra ship coming on board. There's a Preble's coming, and the Benfo is supposed to leave, but they're not leaving right away.
They love Japan.
They're like that. That family member comes over to visit for a week and decides to stay a whole year. That's what's happening. They're staying for a whole year before they move on. So unfortunately, those impacts are the ones you're receiving. However, just so everybody's understands, we will provide a full government-funded move. You will get partial dislocation allowance, and we will definitely work with you to relocate you, main base, Ikego, off base. You let us know, we're gonna work with you. We're gonna make that happen. Unfortunately, what it comes down to is these were not like, this. We have what we call, as I stated earlier, IAP in place. That's a waiver. And that was supposed to go for, we didn't know how long. It was something that was dropped on us by Congress, and they said, tomorrow you're gonna make this happen. And then we say, roger that, and we move forward. I agree with you, it is not the best practice, it is not the best way forward. If I executed the way Congress wanted it, 1 April was when I was moving everybody out. That's pretty much how that worked. So my push with my CEO's authorization was to stop that from happening. And unfortunately, yes, there will be impacts, but my team and me, we're ready to do whatever we possibly can to prevent and minimize impact when it comes to relocation. So we will be looking, if you're request, so you don't have to, you know, grab your kids and move them from point A to point B when it comes to school, we will definitely work with you in identifying homes. As a matter of fact, because with Ichiban and Rokuban, I have the capacity with what we have coming in right now, that's what I'm not currently going for Niban, Sanban, Goban, Yoban. I'm actually waiting a whole year out on those units. But the plan was to knock them all six at the same time. But instead, I'm like, you know, I don't want to impact anybody. However, this is something I put out. If anybody in any of those buildings, their PRD is beyond summer of 25 and they want to move out, let me know. Let my team know. They're going to fund your move. We will fund your move. So CNIC is ready to pay for those moves because they're the ones behind all this. They're the ones that are telling us we need to make this happen.
So can you just, I guess, verify at some point all of the Y towers will be turned into
Yep. Okay. So all two bedrooms will be eventually converted over to UH.
Can I just add something on the sailor piece? What Esteban and his team did with those two towers, and I know I get it, it's a fair comment about a month or 2 months notice, but if we hadn't done that, and it was pressurized by this decision by Congress, it's also pressurized by the changes on the waterfront that are coming with the influx of sailors. If we hadn't pressed to try to get this done by November, I would have had to have moved thousands of sailors back on board the ship with no bare trim team. So it's a tough decision, and I know families are negatively impacted, and that's why Esteban and the team kind of said, hey, let's pick the towers that impact the least amount of families. So it's not an easy decision. Nobody really wanted to do any of this, but it was kind of like, how do we get the best for everybody? So I hope that helps. I know it doesn't make the chaos a little bit better, but that we recognize that we're in the office kind of making that decision, but we try to minimize it as much as possible. But I just want to offer that if that helps a little bit, why we made that decision.
So those single families are going to be in the family residential areas?
That is correct. So all these two-bedroom towers will be all unaccompanied housing.
All the language that we have out in town and stuff like that.
Yes.
The colorful language and stuff.
those are sailors.
Yes, I know they are.
Yes.
I know they are.
No, no.
I understand that, and they'll be in the family residence. Yeah. That's
what he doesn't want to say. But, we have a great relationship, I'd say, on the UH side with our commands, our RAs, and we try to make sure that, you know, we tend to put these commands specifically in specific buildings. That way it's easier to hold folks accountable when things go wrong. Of course, if we go based on what we were informed to do, they want us to pretty much throw the chips everywhere. And you'll have GBUB here, hospital here, CFAY there, and then how do you hold anybody accountable, right? You can't. So via what we're doing, we're actually being able to like maintain commands, command integrity, and so on. So that way, it's easier to support situations when they do arise. We're able to manage them right away, and we've done pretty well with these things.
I have a different question. If we're ready to move on, okay.
Not housing.
It is about housing. I will keep you up there, but it's a different topic. I attended the housing town hall that occurred, a while ago at this point. And one of the big concerns that had been brought up at that point was the issue with the trouble desk and calling them to schedule maintenance requests, especially around the AC units, the molds, and the ceilings and that kind of stuff. During that time, we had been told that we should, when we call in for maintenance requests, that the procedure for them should be to give us a time that they're going to, a schedule that they're gonna come out to our home before we hang up the phone. And what was said at that town hall is to let them know that we were told to say this to them. I have done that, and I have been hung up on. I have been told, no, we absolutely do not do that. When I said, okay, that's fine, I will reach out to housing and I will contact my building supervisor, I was hung up on. And they said, okay, fine. So I wanna bring that up again, because this is something that was told to us about a year ago.
Understood.
Now. And it's really frustrating when we're calling in with something that's happening. And I understand during the summer months, especially right now, it's busy, I get it, they have a lot going on. But we're told something, don't hang up the phone until you get a schedule, because otherwise we're waiting weeks to hear back. And then when that happens, we get hung up on or something else. And that's just really unprofessional. And it's really, yeah. So what can we do? What was done about that following the last town hall?
So did you get the name of the employee you talked to?
Unfortunately, no.
Okay, so that's really where it starts.
Yes.
Because if there's an issue with an employee, we need to have that employee's name so we can properly address it with them. The other thing is, and I'm certainly not saying that happened in this case, but I'm here to tell you, when we do get the name and we go back and we talk to the employee, sometimes details get radically different. So my point is, that's why it's really important to get that employee's name so we can properly follow up with them to make sure that we're addressing the root cause of the problem. And I promise you, these gentlemen up here, they're going to get after the root cause, and they're going to do it most rikki-tikki.
Yes, sir. So the trouble desk is Public Works Department. Family Housing also has a number, and so that maybe some of you get confused for other facility-related services, but the 243-5555 is Public Works. After that town hall, we did publish via various means the procedures. So, like I said, it was a year. I'm sorry if there was miscommunication. The trouble desk does not have the ability to schedule. They receive a work induction. It's two people at a time that work on 8-hour shifts. So the six employees, and I can take your experience back to help correct them or train or understand more. And what we'll do is we'll publish these procedures again via Facebook and the building manager list, and we can send a family housing list as well. They have no ability to schedule work. There's 600 shop employees that do different types of trades, and those two people that take work induction are on that phone almost entirely, constantly. So the procedure is, they take your work request, Public Works makes either a emergency, urgent, or routine visit, and leaves a note on your door if you're not there, you can call back at that time to the number left and schedule. And when you have trouble with Public Works, which I unfortunately sometimes you do depending on workloads and priorities, housing really is a good advocate for you. So if you feel like you have a pressing urgency issue that you weren't heard by the shop that you called, the housing manager you have does a really good job. He knows exactly which door to knock on, and it almost always fixes the problem. They are really good advocates. I wish my process worked every time. Again, you may not see the full picture of what they are working on when you're saying, I need this done on this exact date time. They might be looking at a bigger picture that sometimes a language barrier that communicates that over a phone. Please do call us back when you get that note on the door, and the shop you call will schedule you. And if you feel like that wasn't enough or you need it urgent, housing is a really good advocate via your housing inspector.
Okay, I guess the other concern that I have with that is when I did call and was told, hey, like, we can't schedule you right now, they just showed up randomly the next day. And so luckily, my spouse was home and was able to let them in and they could take care of what our issue was. But so it's like now we're... I appreciated the quick response, don't get me wrong, but then I'm like, okay, what happens if, you know?
I understand.
So do they just not schedule at all? Is that what you're saying?
Exactly as I described. It's sort of like the bus. When we have these work centers that are dealing with a dynamic schedule, we were a contractor and your pipe broke, I'd say, too bad. I got to figure out your pipe, but I don't, right? What I say is, hey, I have a work plan for the day, but I'm gonna go fix this pipe that's affecting this shift today. So we aren't like a private contractor where I can guarantee a contract with you to be there at 8 a.m. Okay. I based off, you know, I was telling a tenant in this building they need something this week. I said, ATG actually flooded a server room and I have to divert that team to do that skill set. So we don't schedule first. We do visit first based on emergency, urgent, or routine buckets, and we leave the note. And so I do understand your feedback. You'd like a schedule first system. We don't think we can execute that.
So I think that was very much miscommunicated at the last town hall, because I am not the only person that...
We'll follow up with written procedures.
Okay, that would be helpful to do that again.
Gets lost.
Like Tyler said, I mean, and you know, at the end of the day, like, if you call, you're not home, they'll leave you a note, you can actually contact and schedule. But at the end of, if for whatever reason you can't get a hold of somebody, call my guys. Call my housing office, our facility folks. That's pretty much what they do. That's their everyday work. They'll go out there, they'll actually even come by, look at the stuff. In some cases it might be something minor that they might be able to support you right away. If it's something that they see that they need an expert to come in and support, they're gonna make that phone call and they're gonna get somebody for you right away. That way you get the support you need right away.
Okay, so that leads me to my next question, kind of related. I understand there's a difference between when we call in to ask for the AC units to be cleaned because there's mold growing on the vents or whatever, versus in my home, my ceiling tiles, I have these types of ceiling tiles and they are stopping wet growing mold on the outside of them. And I understand that those are two different calls. Is that what I'm understanding? Because
if you have that going on, call facilities right away.
I have been.
Yeah, I'll take your information.
If you got wet ceiling tiles in your house, you call me. I'm gonna call Torin, and we're gonna get PrevMed over there.
And this is the. I've been here for 3 summers. This will be the third time that this has happened.
Did you talk to your area inspector? Housing area inspector.
When they came out.
Who did your check in?
Because we track all this. So anytime you call in and you speak to one of my inspectors, they're actually going to go in the system and we track it. And like the CEO mentioned, what we're going to do is we're going to go in there, we're going to go ahead and assess, and as soon as we identify, if we see any possibility of mold, we're going to be calling preventive medicine, we're going to call safety, we're going
to
call everybody. No, definitely.
So you can see
well, I know, but you have to realize, so we'll go out to homes and what we'll find is it's really hot outside. And then normally, what's the air conditioner set at? So
sure.
we're making the house wet from the inside. And a lot of times that happens when people are new to Japan, and they do that. And the house will be sweating from the inside because it's piping hot outside and it's ice cold inside.
And that's just
the way the physics work. And then it doesn't get wiped up, and then it gets left. And then what do you think happens after that? Torin, you want to tell us what happens after that? Mold.
So I live in Himawari, which is a tower that has the built-in dehumidify function, and it's still an issue.
So the there are miscommunications that happen with my blue collar staff that does not have an English proficiency requirement. Many times what I find is the shop that showed up says, this is beyond my shop capability, this is beyond, and so we solve that problem together. I beg you to call your inspector, because he and I personally visit sites, and we say, yeah, I understand why the carpenter couldn't fix this for you, but we can engage the full team to solve the root cause, solve the problem. We've got to escalate it, and the way I ask you to do it is the inspector.
Okay.
Sometimes that carpenter that showed up can't solve the full problem for you.
Okay.
So we'll take your info and we'll definitely show up. We'll be there tomorrow.
I just have a quick, with her, when we call in Public Works and say we have this issue, is there not a reason we can't give them our phone number and say, hey, can you call when you're about to come out to our house? Put that on the message so we can make sure we're there, or we can make sure someone is at the house.
Similar to the Yokosuka, we do not have that. It has to do with language. We don't have a team up here. The Housing Service Center gets funded for that type of capability. We don't have a team that speaks English that can do that for 600 shop employees and 2,000 residents. We just don't have that capability. No, there's not enough English. Pretty much, out of 800 employees in Public Works, there's probably 100 with an English proficiency. And below that, it's Japanese. And so we don't have the capability to call tenants and communicate. We do have a procedure that we'll publish, which is show up based on prioritization of emergency urgent routine, leave a note with your number for a scheduler. And that works for 75 or 80% of the calls. That works for about 75 or more percent of the calls that service happens most quickly that way with the staffing that we have.
And that's the beauty of calling the housing office. All our folks speak Japanese.
That's what I don't understand. I've never had it work.
You can schedule first through housing as well.
Housing maintenance.
So there are some unique cases where they need to schedule first, and they call.
We didn't do that in any of my houses.
Remember, we are take all the bases in Japan.
Yes,
I
understand.
They're still not as big.
I understand. I've been to many bases. So my husband's been active 24 years.
But it's a base.
Several bases, so I do understand that. I'm not a new baby boy. It's been 20 years.
So we do have people with a
specific, I understand.
Let me know my answer. There are people with a specific requirement.
Yeah.
Like I'm only available. They call their inspector and they get scheduled the first time that way. So it is possible again with your inspector say, hey, I don't have this freedom. Can you please? And they do.
Yeah.
They walk over and they communicate that to the right shop. So
yep.
They can solve that unique situation where someone just can't wait for the way forward and can't wait for the second visit.
So am I just understanding correctly that bigger issues like what I've been experiencing, just skip the trouble desk and just
100%.
Yes, sir. If you think it's a bigger issue, we can start there.
Okay.
Yeah. 100%.
Well, if it's a bigger issue, you could always just call me. I'm being honest. I'll come right down to your place.
I do have CMC Hunt's email at this point, so I will type away.
But you know what? I live in housing too. You know what I call for? I'm not dissing anybody. We got the number in the book, and my wife just called, and I was like, what was wrong? She's like, I don't know, I just called, and I'm like, okay, cool.
Pico Housing gets done right away.
Okay. My housing inspector is great, actually. Okay. I've been working a lot with him. My latest issue, I've been having a lot of issues with my doors, which I've been working with my housing inspector, Chris. However, the comment that I wanted to make today is the fact that over the holiday weekend, my door would not lock. And I called maintenance, and they came over, but they couldn't do anything. The locksmith was off until that Tuesday. So basically, I was like, do you just expect me to leave my house unlocked the entire weekend? And they said, yes, because the locksmith's not going to be here until Tuesday.
If you call me, I'll come change your lock.
Okay.
I've done that.
Did nobody else come to the site? It was just one
It was people from maintenance. It was a Saturday. I tried to get a hold of Chris that weekend, but it was a holiday weekend. He wasn't in.
It sounds like it didn't work, so I'm sorry for that. The procedure is they do try to fix it from the outside because that's the only capability we have. But if that can't get done, we call security, and security can get permission to drill out the lock.
Okay. Yeah.
The trouble we have is some tenants don't want us to drill it out, but then you have a hole in the door. Housing has, which actually manages locks, has a agreed to come in on weekends and after hours and actually change the lot so you don't have a hole in your door.
I'm guessing what you have is a digital lot? Is it digital lot?
It is.
Okay, so that's the thing. So all those digital lots are being replaced, especially because, unfortunately, when it comes to the townhouses, we figured out throughout the years, these were being installed in Singapore, and they worked great in Singapore, and Singapore is very humid. So they were like, if it works in Singapore, it's going to work in Japan. No, that's not the case.
I mean, I love my door.
Yeah. But when we're replacing all these doors, obviously those are going to go away. We're going back to keys because obviously that's the practical, easiest way. I used to love that digital lock. Now I'm like, yeah, keys is unfortunately the way we're going to have to go. But as I stated before, if you run into that, I've actually done this for residents. I've had residents that call me, say, Esteban, I don't know what's going on. My lock, mm-hmm. I'm going on vacation tomorrow. And I literally went and said, okay, give me a few minutes, I'll show up. I drove from Hayama, came over, went to the office, grabbed the lock, went over there with a screwdriver, replaced the lock, put it back on, and moved on. Okay. It took me a whole 25 minutes.
That's great, but in that case, when they tell me that they can't do anything, I don't know what your phone number is.
No, well, I will give you that. That's why I'm saying that.
Okay.
I will give you that.
Should we just give everybody on base your phone number?
I would offer the PWD duty officer number is posted, and they can help you, and so can the CFAY CDO. Like I said, we have security join us to authorize the residents, and then we have a choice.
CFAY CDO.
Okay, yeah.
And then we drill it or replace it.
If you contact the CDO calls me every time.
Okay.
For everything, like, and
no
I relate.
There's no way to expect people to just not have their doors locking for an entire week.
Yeah, well,
no. And you're right.
I tell you what we do as well. We'll give our after-hours staff, again, sometimes I find this is language barriers, we'll give our afternoon staff a go-by so that the procedures are written and we don't have any maybe miscommunication of what your choices are.
Yeah, and something we've actually done recently, within the last couple of months we've been doing this, is that we'll just replace your lock completely. Take a digital lock.
I'm waiting on it to be.
Yeah, we'll take your digital out completely and actually go with one of the normal locks with a key, and then you'll never have that problem. So definitely, if you want to do that, Bobby's here, he's listening to this,
about it. Yeah,
we'll go ahead and have it replaced, and then we move forward, and you don't have to call me.
It locked me out, and then it wouldn't lock, and then it locked me out again, and then it wouldn't lock,
and we apologize.
We'll put a key on there, because I don't want you to call this phone.
I'm okay with that.
But I'm glad that the playground's coming back to us.
Is there another question? We've got one in the back.
Hi, I have just a quick question, policy question, I guess. So I recently had a lot of problems in my home. I know Mr. Bobby, Mr. Campbell met me today. Hi, sir. Anyways, I had several instances at my home where I had neighbors come out, unfortunately, on the weekend, and one of them was on Sunday, where only emergency services could be done. But we were told the AC was leaking. We were told it's an outside issue, those people are not working today, not a problem. But they told us, do not turn on these two AC units until the work outside is done. The problem is that one of the rooms was my daughter's room. It is, 100 degrees outside during the day. No fans were offered to me, and the maintenance workers, I understand there's a language barrier. However, I'm just curious, what is the policy from PW or housing on fans being provided to a house that is being told you cannot run your AC until you get this problem fixed?
I'll definitely have to gather all the details on that, but what I will say is I have better things than fans. I have AC units, like floor units, window units that I could provide you. That way you can turn on an AC in that room without having to worry about an AC leaking while we figure out what's going on. So definitely, I apologize, first of all, if that wasn't provided, but same thing, definitely I'll gather the information. Bobby and me will get together and we'll definitely provide those things to make sure that, you know, in the future, if it does come up, like PW team, you know, if it's something that they could do, great. If it's something they can't do, then we'll support it. We'll make sure we make things happen.
I appreciate it. I just want to know for the future.
Yeah, because definitely, like, we have a self-help store that's even open on the weekends, so we can have it in the self-help store.
Thank you for sharing. Anyone else?
Thank you.
Yeah, real quick. So, folks, stay ready, real fast. So, look, and it's pretty simple, right? So, I would say 9 out of 10 times we get it right, but we're here to get it right 10 out of 10 times. So, when we hear about the 1 out of 10 times we don't get it right, man, we take that to heart. And I'm here to tell you, these guys are professionals, and I'm a professional. We're going to do better. We'll do better, and we'll get it right, and we'll get it fixed. But I promise you this, if you contact us and give us the full details, we'll follow up and follow through on it, because that's what we do. And like Commander Gutierrez said, this is the largest Okonis installation the Navy has. Man, we do a lot of volume. And we are focused on taking care of it, because if we get it right 9 out of 10 times, there's one person out of 10 that we don't get it right for, and that's unacceptable. And man, we're all about that. So thanks for the feedback. We'll take it on board, we'll get it better. I know Tyler's gonna talk to the trouble desk a little bit, do some re-education, some training. I think you guys already know now, if you contact the CDO, they're gonna give you the housing director's number. And he's, but I mean, the bottom line is they're going to contact the housing director, and he's going to come out. More important, when you contact the CDO, guess who else the CDO is going to contact? They're going to contact me, and they're going to let me know that somebody has a problem in their home. And I promise you, if I get a I'm a lot of things, lazy ain't one of them. I'll get up and I'll get on it, I promise. Because that's really what it takes. More importantly, that's what you deserve, and that's what you expect, and we'll make it happen. Okay, I'll give you guys the last word. Anybody got anything?
I have something. At one point, I think I remember being, I don't know how long ago, but hearing that the park over at Duncan was not going to be redone as a park. I just appreciate that was, the choice was made to put it as a park and not a grilling area, because they don't have a park over there.
Yeah, well, areas. I'm here to tell you I made that decision.
I just appreciate that.
I pushed parking lot. Just so you know. I pushed parking lot. I'm in full parking.
I live right up there, and my kid has to walk further away.
I just appreciate that decision. I think that was a nice choice.
You won that round.
Yeah, I won that round. Boy Scouts. I want to hear from the Boy Scouts. You guys have anything for us? You guys want to talk about parking?
After that.
What's that
thing by McDonald's that is?
Oh, yes, great question.
So 20 years ago, an association put in a playground there, and it just got old, and eventually got unsafe and was taped off. So it's being replaced by an extension of our ceremonial area, Kasano Park. It's going to be Badger Square and a ceremonial square. That'll be the front entrance for open base events like Fall Festival, Friendship Day. It's also great for re-enlistments. A lot of those kind of things happen there. So it's a ceremonial square that'll attach into Kasano Park.
You know, what, go on, please.
I'm sorry? The new high school complex? Yep, so Dodea is building a new school. They're going to start using the school in fall 27. The building will be done before that, but fall 27 school year, they'll start using the building. The playground, the sports complex is being delivered in phases, and some of the phases may be ready before that.
But really, we talked to Dodea, and they're waiting for the grass to come in.
Wait a year.
So they're going to wait a year for the grass to come in. Once that grass comes in and it gets mature, it gets established, they're going to open it up. Once again, you'll have a better captain, and then it'll also our gift to him. Okay, does anybody else have anything? Boy Scouts, anything else? All right, thank you guys so much, and I appreciate you guys being here. Okay, guys, thanks for showing up. Appreciate you.